Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. In this pep talk where I will be talking about the parents of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are they in hellfire? Are they in paradise? Or what is the third alternative? And I want to start by saying that people are always attracted by the unknown. Everyone wants to know what is exactly in paradise right now, what's going to happen in the grave. Man is always drawn into the mystical, something where he doesn't have control over, so they want always to know what goes on in there. So, this issue about the Prophet's parents, was it an issue in the early days of Islam? When did it really start? And why would a man go to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all the people that lived around Rasulullah, as this is told to us, knew his stature, that Rasulullah is the final prophet. And he had such a high place in the sight of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. He was highly regarded. Why would a man go and ask him such a question that would put Rasulullah in a very, very saddening situation? I want you to imagine this. Someone comes to you, let's say you embraced Islam, someone who has just came to Islam, and then you would go and ask him about his parents, where they are, where they are going to be. And isn't it very hard and difficult on a person to tell you that my dad is in hellfire for eternity? We all know how much our parents mean to us, even if you have issues with your parents now. But one day they will pass away, and one day you will realize their values. We all know that Rasulullah was a very loving man who loved dearly his parents, even though he never got to see his father and he lived for a small period of time with his mother. But he is a human being, and as such, he has a tendency to love his parents just like you and me. And if he hasn't seen his father, he certainly would have heard about how great his father was. I'm sure his other uncles, whose brother is Abdullah, his dad, had told Rasulullah certain things about his father. But anyway, so here is a situation where we are asked about the status of the parents of Rasulullah. And it is man that a man came to Rasulullah and he said, "Aina Abi? Where is my dad?" And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, so it's very authentic from the aspect of the hadith science. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Finnar," i.e. your father is in hellfire. So when the man turned to leave and go away, it is reported that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called him back, and then he said, "Inna abi wa abaka finnar." My father and your father are both in the fire. And as I said, this is in Muslim and other books of hadith. As for his mother, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it is also reported in Muslim, in Sahih Muslim, when he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, "Ista'dhantu Rabbi an astaghfira li ummi." I sought permission from Allah, my Lord, to ask forgiveness for my mother. "Walakin Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala lam ya'dhir li." But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not grant him the permission to seek forgiveness for his mother. "واستأذنته أن أزور قبرها فأذن لي." And I sought his permission to visit her grave, and Allah granted it, that permission, to him. And this hadith again is in Muslim. And then he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, "فَزُورُوا الْقُبُورَ فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُ الْمَوْتِ." As such, visit the graves, for it reminds you of death. In another hadith, also by Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he reports that we were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there was about 1,000 riders, warriors and knights with him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he halted somewhere, he stopped somewhere and performed 2 rak'at sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he turned back to the companions with tears in his eyes. Upon seeing this, Umar radiallahu anhu went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said to him, "May my parents be ransomed for your safety, ya Rasulullah. What's the matter?" And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, "Inni sa'altu Rabbi fi istighfarin li ummi." I had sought permission from my Lord, from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, to seek a forgiveness for my mother, but Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala لم يأذن لي. He didn't grant me that permission. فدمعت عيناي. So my eyes became tearful. رحمة لها من النار. Because of, out of mercy for her, because of her place in hellfire. Also in another hadith, in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, a man came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, is reported to have come to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and asked him, أين أمي? Where is my mother? Now this time he's asking about the mother. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم answered back, أمك في النار. Your mother is in hellfire. The man then commented, asking, فأين من مضى من أهلك? So where are those who passed away from your family? And then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أما ترضى أن تكون أمك مع أمي? Wouldn't you be satisfied that your mother is with my mother, i.e. both of them in hell fire? And as I said, this hadith is reported by Ahmad and At-Tabarani, and they say the chain of narrators is thiqat, i.e. trustworthy, reliable, i.e. the hadith has got some truth in it. And also authenticated by Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani in his work or his book entitled Dhilalul Jannah, the Shades of Paradise. And again, he said, because of the shawahid, the different roots on how the hadith got to us. So different roots are weak, but the, all of them together, they make an authentic hadith. I will deal with this, inshallah, when I deal with the science of hadith and explain all this science, bi-idhnillah. The school of the Salafi today, or the Wahhabis today, are or always preach that both Rasulullah's parents are in hellfire, and so did the previous scholars until Ibn Taymiyyah, and until actually the gathering of the hadith, and that is in the third century after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prior to that, we didn't know. It's only after that that this became an issue. Obviously, there are some books of hadith that have been compiled before Bukhari and Muslim that had this issue. But I won't go that much into details, because what I want to talk about today is actually, are the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in really hellfire, or aren't they? Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah, in his compilation of the fatwa in volume 4, page 326, actually theorizes this idea of the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and actually cements it in the belief of Muslims today. He said, "Inna al-khabar amma kana wa yakun la yadkhuluhu naskh." I.e., any narrations, any tellings about what has happened and what will happen in the future, in the day of Qiyamah, will not be abrogated. What he means by this, the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun took place. Nobody can abrogate that. And what's going to happen on the day of Qiyamah, for example, when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says in Abu Lahab, sayasla naran dhat al-lahab, that Abu Lahab will be burnt in a very fearful fire. Or when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala spoke about Al-Walid, when he said, سَأُرْهِقُهُ صَعُودًا, i.e. I will soon constrain him to a very hard ascent in hellfire. So these two punishments will take place. They will not be abrogated. Also, people who do good will go to Jannah. That won't be abrogated. And then he adds into that, وَكَذَلِكَ فِي إِنَّ أَبِي وَأَبَاكَ فِي النَّارِ. And then he said, and the case is the same also for when Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, my father and your father are in hell. And إِنَّ أُمِّي وَأُمَّكَ فِي النَّارِ. And also for my mother and your mother are in hellfire. And then he said, وَهَذَا لَيْسَ خَبَرًا عَنْ نَارٍ يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا صَاحِبُهَا كَأَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ. And then he said, this is not an information about a fire whose inhabitants can live as the people who commit major sins will one day be punished for those sins, and then they will come out from that hellfire. Then he said, لِأَنَّهُ لَوْ كَانَ كَذَلِكَ لَجَزَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارُ لَهُمَا. And then he said, because if the case for the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ, that they would leave hellfire, then Allah would have authorized the Prophet ﷺ to make or to seek forgiveness for them. What he means also, what he says also, is that since Allah did not authorize his messenger to make forgiveness, to ask forgiveness for them, this means that the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ will not come out of hellfire, and that they will dwell in there for eternity. What Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah says is not his view only, or his opinion only, but is also the view of a huge, great number of scholars from Muslim, Ibn Taymiyyah, Al-Bukhari, Al-Nawawi, Al-Tabarani, Al-Qurtubi, Ibn Qayyim Al-Jawziyyah, and in our times, Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, the High Council of scholars in Saudi Arabia, the whole Salafi Wahhabi school of thought, including the lenient ones or the orthodox extreme hard ones, Sheikh Al-Munajjid, who is the operator of Islam QA, the Salafi in Egypt, like Muhammad Hassan, Mustafa Al-Adawi, and there are people here in the UK. As a matter of fact, wherever you go in the world where it has the Salafi school of thought, they will always tell you that the parents of Rasulullah and his uncle Abu Talib are all in hellfire for eternity. My talk today is about the parents of Rasulullah, not about Abu Talib, the uncle of Rasulullah. I will dedicate another talk for him later on, inshallah. Before we flip the coin and check the other side of this story, let me refresh your memory about the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born to a man and a woman. The man's name is Abdullah, who is the son of Abdul Muttalib, son of Hashim, and Hashim is from Quraysh. Now, just for information, Abu Talib, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who adopted Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, took care of him, fought for him, supported him, and all that kind of stuff, is the brother of our Prophet's father. What this means is that Ali radiallahu anhu is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Quraysh is from Al-Musta'riba. Quraysh is not purely Arab. They became Arab at the time of Ismail alayhi salam, when a well-known tribe called Jurham came all the way from Al-Yemen and they settled in Mecca, as we all know the story. So that's how Quraysh began their journey into becoming Arabs. But from his mother sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his mother's name is Amina, daughter of Wahb, and she died in 577 Christian era. The Arabs before, to preserve their tribes and strength and everything, wouldn't marry to somebody out of from their tribe. That's why today it's extremely very difficult to find a Saudi woman married to a man from, say, Japan or from North Africa or something. It's just they marry tribe within the tribe within the tribe. So it happened that Rasulullah's parents met and married each other because both of them actually are from Quraysh, even though his mother sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in Al-Madinah. She meets her husband in their fifth grandfather, whose name is Hakim ibn Murrah, or also known as Kilab. So they were both from the same tribe. That's why the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam got married together. Simply put, Abdullah, the father, was a beautiful, strong, good-looking, handsome young man. He was full of life, intelligent and reliable. He was also very honorable and trustworthy. He was a business person and an accomplished entrepreneur. And as for his mother, Amina, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was a beautiful, honorable, full of life young girl. She was really pretty and she was really beautiful. She was also trustworthy. She was chaste, incredible passion for life, and a source of love for the man who deserves her. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wanted it to be the father of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said in Sahih al-Bukhari, بُعِثْتُ مِنْ خَيْرِ قُرُونِ بَنِي آدَمَ قَرْنًا فَقَرْنًا. I have been sent as an apostle, as a messenger of Allah, in the best of all generations of Adam's offspring since their creation. حَتَّى كُنْتُ مِنَ الْقَرْنَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ فِيهِ, until I came to the where he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mecca, and he was born from the best of generations. What this also means, that since Allah created Adam, and as I've already spoken about this, Allah had decreed that this sperm, or this drop of sperm here that lives in this man and in this woman here, is going to be the messenger of Allah. And as such, since the birth of Adam alayhi salam until Rasulullah was born, Rasulullah was always in the best of generations. And it is impossible for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to put that beautiful, how do I put it, a drop of sperm and bit of egg from the dad and the mother in the wombs of people that would worship others than Allah. This is why, and this is one of the arguments used by people that report that the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ weren't disbelievers, is because since Adam, the drop of sperm or whatever is made that Rasulullah ﷺ, like a drop of sperm and the egg from the mother, always were traveling from the best, purest of humans until he was born from his dad and his mother. How the marriage took place was undocumented, because back then A, it was not the norm to write about any marriage, and B, no one knew that from these two young people, i.e. Abdullah the father and Amina the mother, would come the most honorable person, the seal of the prophets, the one who's gonna bring the final message on earth. Nobody knew that, and as such, nobody paid a huge deal of attention. Therefore, in the Salafi world, the idea about the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sealed. That's it, it's the end of it. They are in hellfire for eternity. So much so that they said, any disagreement about this issue or agreement with it are irrelevant and won't be of any value, because the matter has already been decreed and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spoken, and he himself has witnessed that his parents, both of them, will be for eternity in hellfire, and also his uncle. So they say, no matter what this is, whatever, whoever says, that's it, it's decided. And as I've already mentioned before, that the great number of scholars from Al-Bukhari, Al-Muslim, after that, the many people in the pre-Ibn Taymiyyah era, and also after him, until Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came, and then the Wahhabi school of thought, and then the scholars of today, all of them basically agree that the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ are in hellfire. So much so that if you try to defend them, you get in big, big trouble. So now that we know where the evidences are, actually, is that true? Are the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ in hellfire? Let's first and before anything establish some reality, some truth that everyone would agree with. Because you see, when you start debating an issue, if you don't agree on what you are talking about or what you are going to discuss or you're going to debate or you're going to challenge, and what are your tools, anyone can say anything and everybody would get nowhere. It is very, very sad that, as I have already mentioned, all roads are blocked in the face of the parents of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and eternity in hellfire is their fate. And no one can challenge that. But we will challenge that, and we will tell and say, alhamdulillah, what I personally believe in. And I am not the only one. There are gazillions of other people and scholars that think that. And because we are not bound to any organization or any country or anything, we can say what we truly believe in, as opposed to when you belong to an organization, you can't say what you want to say, because the moment you say something that is out of what the other organization wants you to say, then you are in big, big trouble. Before I proceed, my dear sisters and my brothers, I would like to clarify that my goal is not to prove that his parents are in Jannah or Paradise, or that they died as believers. My intention is to actually show you the other side of the coin. And once you know the two sides of the coin, you can choose to which side you want to look. Because on the day of judgment, Allah will hold you responsible on what you, the listener, have believed in. What you say is how you got there. On the day of judgment, you can't just turn to Allah and say, I believed in this because people said. You need an evidence. This is why knowledge is compulsory on every Muslim, both men and women. No excuse to that. But it is also just sad, really so sad, that our scholars didn't in general take the clear message presented in the Quran. And this is our downfall, Muslims. We always prioritize the hadith as it is the ultimate evidence from heaven. And so much so, the other day I was listening to a scholar, and he said that Rasulullah was given two revelations, the Quran and the Sunnah. And my brothers and my sisters, this, even though it might sound to you truth or whatever, it actually is absolutely wrong. Allah revealed one thing and one thing only to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is Al-Quran. The Sunnah is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that did not contradict the Quran. But as you will see, inshallah, and I intend to have a series called Contradictions, where I will show you clearly how tons of ahadith contradict the Quran and how we Muslims are following what the hadith says, and at the same time we are contradicting the Quran. This is why the wrath, anger and punishment of Allah is upon us, because Al-Quran is always the second, even though we claim to be the following the Quran on first. Everybody says we follow the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah, but actually this is untrue. So let me start by saying, we all know that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is just. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a transgressor, nor is he an oppressor, nor is he a tyrant dictator, either in this life or in the hereafter. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has cemented this ultimate truth when he said in Al-Quran, "Man 'amila salihan fali nafsih." Whoever does good, it is to their own benefit. وَمَنْ أَسَاءَ فَعَلَيْهَا. And whoever does evil, it is to their own loss, i.e. it's against them. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. And your Lord is never unjust or a tyrant to his creatures. Meaning, on the day of Al-Qiyamah, nobody can come to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and says, "Ya Allah, I didn't want to drink wine, but you made me drink wine because you have decreed that I should drink wine." This idea of the decree, the belief in the decree and the predestination, al-iman bil-qada wal-qadar, it's an innovated term. Nowhere in Al-Quran Allah asks us or commands us to believe in the decree and predestination. The belief in the decree and predestination is an invention by Banu Umayyah, by Muawiyah. Because when people told him, "Ya Muawiyah, why did you fight Ali and took the Khilafah and you killed and you did all this?" He said, "It was decreed by Allah that I become the leader, the king, the Khalifa, whatever. Anyone who said otherwise had been killed." There were so many murders before to make people believe that the decree and predestination is part of our belief. Nowhere in Al-Quran you would find this belief. Allah has spoken to belief in Allah on the last day, the malaika, the angels, the hereafter, the books, all this has mentioned in Al-Quran. But nowhere you will find the belief in the decree and predestinations. This is why people today, when they do things, when they make miscalculations, they marry the wrong people, they say, "This is what Allah has decreed." Such is an accusation of Allah. Allah did not decree on you who you are going to marry. You chose it based on your instinct, based on your love, based on everything. On the day of Al-Qiyamah, you cannot come to Allah and tell him, "Ya Allah, you made me married so and so because you wrote it down." This is not true, because Allah is not dhallamin lil'abid. Allah is not unjust and Allah is not a tyrant. But anyway, so therefore, humans are at the mercy of their own deeds, and Allah will deal with them on the day of Al-Qiyamah based on the actions and the choices they make. So my dear sisters and brothers, be aware of this. So Allah is fair, just, and not tyrant, and He will not rule against anyone in the sense of injustice. The second absolute reality: to hold people responsible and accountable for their actions on the day of judgment, and to avoid being unjust and tyrannic, Allah took practical steps to help guide the free-willed mankind that Allah created, so that on the day of Al-Qiyamah, no one will use the argument, "I didn't know," or "You didn't tell us," or "How would I know? You hadn't sent any messenger to me." So to close all those things, the second absolute reality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not punish anyone that hasn't received guidance or warnings in the title of messengers. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throws in a hypothetical scenario. And he says, وَلَوْ أَنَّا أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ. And if we had destroyed them with a punishment before it, i.e. before the coming of Al-Qur'an by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what would they say on the Day of Judgment? لَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا لَوْلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. They would have said on the Day of Judgment, our Lord, only had you sent to us a messenger. فَنَتَّبِعَ آيَاتِكَ. We would have followed your revelations, your ayat in the Qur'an, مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن نَذِلَّ وَنَخْزَى, before being humiliated and put to shame on the Day of Judgment. And this is in Surah Taha, that is the Surah number 20 and the Ayah 134. And Surah Taha is of the earliest of what was revealed in Mecca. In another Ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْلَا أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ. Also, so that they would not say, if struck by an affliction for what their hands have done on the Day of Qiyamah, رَبَّنَا لَوْلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. Our Lord, if only you had sent us a messenger, فَنَتَّبِعَ آيَاتِكَ, we would have followed your revelation, that is the ayat in Al-Qur'an, وَنَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and we are, or we become, of the believers. And this surah, or this ayah, is in Surah Al-Qasas, and the ayah 47, that is the Surah 28, ayah 47. So as you see here, always the excuse of, Ya Allah, had you done that, we would have been this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closes this argument. And this speech is directly directed to Quraysh, before anyone else, because as I said, Taha was revealed and Al-Qasas were revealed in Mecca in the early days of Islam. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, my dear sisters and my brothers, tells us what argument people would use to escape accountability and punishment on the Day of Judgment. So Allah did everything to close the door for this kind of argument. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He sent messengers, He well described their functions. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. Messengers are bearers of good news and also at the same time are warners. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ. So that people would have no proof or argument or anything on the Day of Judgment against Allah. Because once the prophets come in, they have been warned. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. And Allah was always, still is, mighty and absolutely wise. So as you can, and this is in Surah An-Nisa, the Surah number 4, the Ayah 165. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has defined the functionality and the job of the prophets. No one can turn to Allah on the Day of Judgment and says, Ya Allah, I didn't know. Obviously, what this means, my dear sisters and my brothers, is that the messenger has to come and people have to understand it. Today in the West, today where we live today, and the way Islam is being misrepresented by Muslims themselves in their countries and also by the different medias worldwide. So we cannot go in the street to, for, say, an English, an American or French or whatever person, and you tell them believe in Islam, and once they don't believe, you say you are kafir and end of it. No, that's not how it functions. Allah knows how these people believe, how they think. It is up to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to take care of them. It is none of our business to do anything or to judge them or anything. Leave them to Allah. And again, I will cover this inshallah another day. So now that we understand the purpose behind the dispatching of messengers throughout times, and the dispatching was a promise, the sending of messengers to mankind, my dear sisters and my brothers, is a promise that Allah made to Adam and his wife, or our parents, when they came out from Jannah. Allah promised them that He will send every time a guidance, Huda. فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَيَهُ, whoever follows my guidance shall never err and shall never be misguided. That guidance will come through prophets and messengers. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it upon himself to send messengers. The third, and this leads me to say, the third absolute reality, and that the messengers speak the tongue of his people. And once the messenger is gone, the book he leaves stays with the people until Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala either sends another messenger, and if no messengers come, then the book stays with his people. This is why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن رَسُولٍ, and whenever we sent a messenger to his people, إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ, except with the tongue, the language of his people. What this means is, if the English people spoke English, Allah would not send them a messenger who spoke French. He would send them a messenger who speaks English, just like the same tongue as the other, لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ, to clearly convey and explain the message to them as Allah wants it. And this is in Surah Ibrahim, the Surah number 14, the Ayah number 4. So, where is the book left to Quraysh by the messenger who came? Knowing that Quraysh didn't have any messenger from Ismail alayhi salam, and the period of time between Quraysh and Ismail is over 3,000 years. I'll come back to this later, inshallah. The fourth absolute reality, my dear sisters and my brothers, that the period between Ismail and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam is what is known in Arabic al-Fatrah, or the interruption of revelation, when there is no revelation whatsoever. Just like it happened between Musa alayhi salam until the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam, or between Isa alayhi salam and our time, or between any prophet and his people where there was no revelation whatsoever, that is called al-fatra, or the interruption in revelation. And so, as I said it before, that the time between Ismail alayhi salam and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is, or Quraysh, is more than 3,000 years. To put it a little bit simpler, that is 30 centuries between Ismail alayhi salam, more than 30 centuries between Ismail and Quraysh. Between us and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is only what? 10 centuries between Quraysh and Ismail is 30 centuries. This is why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says to the people of the book, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, people of the book, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولُنَا, our messenger has come to you, يُبَيِّنُ لَكُمْ عَلَى فَتْرَةٍ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ, making things clear to you after a break in the sequence of messengers, i.e. interruption in the revelation, أَنْ تَقُولُ, so that you don't say on the day of judgment, مَا جَاءَنَا مِنْ بَشِيرٍ وَلَا نَذِيرٍ, no bringer of good news, nor any warner has come to us. فَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بَشِيرٌ وَنَذِيرٌ, indeed now, i.e. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has come to you as a bringer of good news and a warner. And this is in Surah Al-Ma'idah number 5, and the ayah is 19, and Surah Al-Ma'idah is one of the latest of what has been revealed in Al-Quran. There is Al-Ma'idah, and right after it is Surah At-Tawbah, and that's that. So it is very clear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concedes the past, where no messenger period has happened, the interruption of the revelation, as said, is the period of Al-Fatrah. And between Quraysh again and Ismail is a 3,000 pure more years. Quraysh, my dear brothers and my sisters, had an idea, but they didn't have a book. They had the Chinese whisper. Somebody said something, I heard of something, but there was nothing that they could sink their teeth in when it came to a matter of their religion. So let's see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Quraysh. Does he consider them as people who have received the revelation, people that had a religion? Or does he consider them elsewhere? So, Allah says in Surah Yasin that everybody knows about this surah. Allah says, Yasin, wal Qur'an al-Hakim. Yasin, by the Qur'an that is wise. Innaka lamin al-mursaleen. You certainly are, Ya Muhammad, one of the messengers. Ala siratin mustaqim. Upon a straight path. Tanzeel al-Aziz al-Rahim. This straight path is a descendant of the Almighty, the Merciful, that is Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا, to warn a people, and this is Quraysh in primary, مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, whose forefathers weren't warned, i.e. they didn't have any warner, فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ, and for that they are unaware and heedless. And as I said, this is Surah 36, that is Yasin, from the ayah 1 till 6. And ma in Arabic, my dear sisters, it negates the verb from its root, i.e. it never happened. And ma is more powerful in negation than lam. If Allah said lam yatihim, it's weaker in negation than when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ma atahum, i.e. Quraysh has not received a messenger before you. This goes along with the promise of Allah that He made to our parents, Adam and his wife, when they came out from Al-Jannah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْنَا هَبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا, and we said, descend from it, you all. فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدًى, so when a guidance from me comes to you, فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ, so whoever follows my guidance, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ, there shall be no fear for them on judgment day, وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, nor they shall be of grievance here in this life. And this is in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, and the ayah is number 38. And since that time, i.e. since the descendants of our parents from Jannah, humanity has always received a very comforting promise, and a promise from our beautiful God. This unbelievable promise is that every human will not be punished until and unless they received a clear messenger to show them and clearly demonstrate to them what is right and what is wrong. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا, and in no way we are to torture or punish, torment or anything like that, anyone, حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا, until we have sent a messenger to convey the message and guidance of Allah. Allah is clear, my dear sisters and my brothers, that anyone on judgment day that will come to Allah when is asked about why you worship a crocodile or you worship this or cross or whatever it is, when the person says, and Allah knows what goes into the inner parts of every human being, when the person says, Ya Allah, I didn't receive a clear message from you, Allah knows if the person has or has not, and based on that, Allah will hold the person responsible. Unlike so many people, as I will get back to it later, when they went too much into unneeded details and to take away the parents of Rasulullah ﷺ from this matter that they haven't received a messenger. On the day of Al-Qiyamah, my dear sisters and my brothers, as Allah again explicitly says it in Al-Quran, وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ, and every single human since Adam until the last person Allah creates, أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِي عُنُقِهِ, we have bound each human's destiny to his own neck. You are responsible for your own destiny. You cannot hold anyone else responsible. If you are drinking or taking drugs or fornicating, you cannot blame somebody else but your own self. You are bound by your own destiny. وَنُخْرِجُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كِتَابًا, and we shall bring out for him or for her on the day of standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a book. That book is what is referred to in Surah Al-Kahf, when people will look at the book and they will say, يَا وَيْلَتَنَا مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابَ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا, woe unto us, why does this book have collected and have written and have witnessed every small thing and every big thing that we have done in our lives. That book there, the person will come on it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَلْقَاهُ مَنْشُورًا, that book will be found wide open and spread in front of each one of us, each one of us with their own book. And then Allah tabaraka ta'ala will command the person, اقرأ كتابك, read your own book. And what a blood freezing command that is. You read your own book of action, and then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, كَفَى بِنَفْسِكَ الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكَ حَسِيبًا. Enough is your own self to hold yourself accountable. You read the book and you will acknowledge from your own self, yeah, Allah, I did wrong and I didn't wrong. Now let me ask you a question. If a person, let's say we're going to take somebody who lives in the Amazon's jungle right now, they in their own belief, in the way they've grown and all that kind of stuff, they drink wine. I'm just going to give an example, right? On the day of Al-Qiyamah, when Allah brings him, He's going to ask him, read your book. When the person reads his book, because they haven't received a messenger to tell them that in the Quran Allah prohibits alcohol, Allah will not hold the person responsible for drinking alcohol, because the person cannot judge himself on himself with something he doesn't have, and that is knowledge, the guidance. You need guidance. People who fornicate today, on the day of judgment, will they be able to say to Allah, Ya Allah, fornication is halal? You didn't say. Everybody knows that fornication is haram. Everybody knows killing is haram. Everybody knows taking drugs is haram. Everybody knows. So when people do today sins, they know these sins are sins. So, my dear sisters and my brothers, now, for the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and with the Quran being the absolute authentic truth, they are the words of Allah beyond any shadow of doubt. If Allah tells that Quraysh, the whole of Quraysh, they have not received anyone to warn them. They have not received. So, the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died before his coming. Do they qualify for such a description? Of course they do. But our scholars of Islam, sadly and very heart-bleeding sadly, they chose to ignore the message of Al-Quran. And what did they say? They said, since Allah revealed to Rasulullah that his parents aren't part of those people that didn't receive the message, i.e. the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam have received, Allah al-Azim is strange, have received the message of Ismail, i.e. the message of Ismail has traveled to them 3,000 years and over. And they were fully aware that what the Quraysh was doing is wrong. And because of that, they're going to stay in eternity in hellfire. When Allah says, لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ أَبَاهُمْ, the whole people haven't received a message. If Allah says the whole people, how can we say that the hadith says only these two or three people? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we know in Muslim and other authentic books, it says when our mother Aisha was asked about him, his behavior, his moral, she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. He was Al-Qur'an. He was the human manifestation of Al-Qur'an. If Allah in Al-Qur'an says that the people of Quraysh haven't received, Allah in the Qur'an didn't say بَعْضُ مِنْهُمْ. Some of them have, some of them haven't. Allah says all of them haven't received the message. How can Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would utter something that would contradict Al-Qur'an? It is impossible. But the sad news is our scholars today, they always speak, but they can't be spoken to. For example, when Ibn Baz, alayhi rahmatullah, when he's the head of the Saudi Salafi, Wahhabi, whatever it is, when he spoke about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, parents, he says they don't have fire. Can we actually argue with him and talk to him? No, we can't. You can't discuss, you can't challenge anything. They only say it and that's that. And when they wrote in their books, they will insult you 1,000 times, as if you say, I don't accept the hadith because the hadith says, my parents and the Quran says, the whole people haven't received. If you say, I don't believe in that, they will tell you, you fight the sunnah, you are against the sunnah, you are someone who hates the sunnah, you want to destroy the sunnah, demolish the sunnah, blah, 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 blah. All these things so that you can't use your mind to prioritize Al-Quran. On the day of Al-Qiyamah, my dear sisters and my brothers, when the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, when they say, Ya Allah, you haven't sent a messenger to us, Allah will not tell them there was a messenger whose life was 3,000 years. If Allah, for the people, the Christians, there was between them, Jesus, between when Jesus ended his function as a messenger and the coming of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were 600 years. And Allah calls them على فترة من الرسل, there was no revelation between Jesus and Rasulullah. How can we say there was a revelation between 3,000 men, Ismail and our prophet? How can they not see this one? Now someone is going to say, hang on. You saying that you, or not myself, because there are other people, believe it or not, Abu Bakr al-Maliki, it's a great scholar in Andalus from Spain, about 800 years ago, has issued a fatwa saying that anyone who says that the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are in hellfire is cursed. This has angered, and recently Al-Azhar in Egypt, the High Council of Al-Azhar in Egypt, issued the same fatwa that anyone that says that the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are in hellfire is cursed. And this has angered the Salafi people, the Wahhabi people, and one of them is Ishaq al-Huwaini. He starts like getting angry and he says, how can Al-Azhar? And then he said, is Muslim, is Al-Nawawi, is Al-Bayhaqi all cursed? Guess what? If they go against the Quran, I don't care what they are. They are humans just like you and me. On the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah will ask me and you personally. And once you say, Ya Allah, you said in your book that you have not sent any messenger to the Arabs, Quraysh and on, and that stands true. Yeah, and it's really, I'm not going to get into more details about the scholars, but just be aware that all the Salafi, everyone that calls himself Salafi there or Wahhabi in Saudi Arabia believes 100% that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's parents are in hellfire, when we know they are not. They are of the people that haven't received the revelation, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about them on the day of Al-Qiyamah. Allah will test them, He will decide, He will put them in Jannah straight away. That is up to Allah. What I'm saying now is the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are under the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so is everyone else that hasn't received the true message of Al-Islam. Despite of what I said and the Quran and everything, they will come to you as Salafi or Wahhabi or whoever, and they will say, nope, the hadith is in Sahih Muslim, it's in Muslim, and as such, it's a revelation. I swear to Allah, the Almighty, that what's in Al-Bukhari and Muslim are 90% of them are not a revelation. A small, tiny minority of the hadiths are. Other than that, they are narrations reported to us by people. Just like we say the Bible, just like we say some different things about other people. And what's in books of hadith is not 100% of what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And let me tell you how is that. We all know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was in Mecca for the first 13 years, he had pure enemies. Quraysh hated him. For 13 years, no more than probably 80 people had embraced Islam. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, my dear sisters and my brothers, there were about 300 people from Mecca that were Muslims and about 4,000 people that were Muslims in Al-Madinah. And the rest of them were scattered. Even they say at the end of his life in Hajjat al-Wada, there were 120,000. Some others say 114,000 people that embraced Islam. But that is only an estimate number. Nobody counted them hand by hand. Maybe someone saw a lot of people and they can considered that, and the number came later on. With the researches I made about this topic, I came to find out a very sad, dark, and sickening reality that you need to be aware of. And that is the Banu Umayya vendetta against Bani Hashim. Banu Umayya are from Uthman radiallahu anhu, who was murdered, and then after him came Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan and Hind and all these people. Muawiyah and his father Abu Sufyan embraced Islam after the opening or the conquest of Mecca, and they were of those people who were scared, and they were the set free, the people, the at-tulaqa, people that were set free by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he could have really killed them because of their betrayal and all what they did. But him being sallallahu alaihi wasallam a mercy to mankind, he set them free. I wanted to understand this and realize this. Why Banu Umayyah, who took control of the Muslim land after the murder of Ali radiallahu anhu, and they are the responsible for all this kind of ahadith of belittling the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, put them in hellfire, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let me tell you a little bit of history and you will understand how this hadith came to be invented. Always remember that Abu Sufyan was the leader of Quraysh after the battle of Badr. In the second year after the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, i.e. 15 years after the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the great battle of Badr took place. And in Badr, a great number of Abu Jahl and Utbah and Rabi'ah and all these people and Walid got killed. So Abu Sufyan became the governor of Quraysh. And it is him who fought Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the next about 10 years. And he was him, the sworn enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for various reasons. Muawiyah grew up in the hate of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How can that not be, knowing that Abu Sufyan again was the sworn enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was also a dedicated and declared enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a direct enemy of him for more than 20 years, as I said. The mother of Muawiyah, Hind, was the lady who chewed the liver of Hamza. She was not the one who had commissioned Wahshi to kill, but once she found Hamza killed, Wahshi killed Hamza for his own freedom, and he was commissioned by his master. But once Hind found Hamza killed, she opened his chest, and she got his liver and chewed it, and then she spat it out. So Muawiyah had two parents that hated the guts of Banu Hashim, namely Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and anyone who comes from that tribe. His paternal auntie of Muawiyah is Jamil, who is the mother or the wife of Abu Lahab. She is the one that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَمَرَأَتُهُ حَمَّالَةَ الْحَطَبِ, and his wife is the one who carries the wood for her fire. And that woman there is the paternal auntie of Muawiyah. So as you can see now, he is surrounded by the hatred of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from all angles. Not to forget, my dear sisters and my brothers, that his maternal uncles from his mother, Al-Walid, the son of Utbah, who was killed by Ali in Badr. So Muawiyah and Abu Sufyan hold personal grudges against Ali for killing who? His uncle. And also his maternal grandfather, Utbah, son of Rabi'ah, who was killed by Hamza, also in Badr. So as you can see, a great number of the family of Banu Sufyan and Muawiyah and Banu Umayyah were killed by Banu Hashim in Badr. Also his maternal grandfather's brother, Shayba, son of Rabi'ah, who was killed by Ali and Hamza. So wherever you turn your face, you would find that Muawiyah grew up with a dedicated hate factory for Banu Hashim in general, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in particular, and Ali in particular. This is why later on, when Muawiyah was claiming that he wanted to fight for the blood of Uthman and all that kind of stuff, and the great battles that took place between Muawiyah and Ali, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that Muawiyah, Ammar ibn Yasir, was in the group of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Ammar ibn Yasir will be killed by the transgression party, and the leader of that transgression party was, guess who? Muawiyah. So when Muawiyah, I'm just going to kind of like shorten a whole long story. When Ali was killed radiallahu anhu, Al-Hasan, his son, took the Khilafah for 6 months, and then again there was an alarming type of there was going to be another battle between Al-Hasan and Muawiyah, and that's when Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, the grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, gave up his right, was forced to give up his right to the Khilafah, and gave it and handed it over to Muawiyah. Muawiyah, what he did, since the time he got it, and he ruled about another 30 years, what he did, He issued rules throughout the land, and for the next 92 years, the name of Ali was cursed every Jummah. People used to curse Ali like you would curse a shaitan. That was a decree by Muawiyah. Anything that the Banu Umayyah could do to belittle Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or belittle Ali was done. They could not insult Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly, so they took it over after Ali. In a way to harm Ali was to tell Ali that Abdullah, who is your uncle, is in hellfire. And Amina bint Wahab, who is a relative of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is in hellfire. Your father, Abu Talib, is in hellfire. And if they could say to him, Rasulullah is in hellfire, Muawiyah would have said it to him. Now, you might say, like, why? This is, my dear sisters and my brothers, the part of history that is hidden from us, the people of the Sunnah. This is why every time you want to speak about the past, they will tell you, don't speak about what happened between the Sahaba, it's gone. Actually, it's not gone. It's still alive amongst us today. And at times, I feel that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is keeping the Shia alive so that we, the people of the Sunnah, will wake up one day and realize the great evil that has been done by Banu Umayyah. Do you know why they consider Umar ibn Abdul Aziz as the fifth Khalifa? Well, every Jumu'ah, Banu Umayyah would curse Ali and they would hold a khutbah from the Dhuhr until Maghrib. And they used to, at the end of every khutbah, curse Ali. It was the Sunnah to curse Ali, and curse they did. Until Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, Ali rahmatullah, came and he took off and took away the curse of Ali and replaced it. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر and so on until the end of the ayah. It is Umar ibn Abdul Aziz that changed it. This is why in Jumu'ah now, every time you hear your imam recite this ayah at the end of the khutbah, just realize that one time when instead of reciting that ayah, people would curse Ali. So as you can see here, there is a personal vendetta, and this type of ahadith were invented. And the sad news is, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even after that, my dear sisters and my brothers, and I end my talk with this. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive, and there were people fabricating lies about him. They were making up things. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam many times said, من كذب علي متعمدا, whoever lies about me on my behalf deliberately, I says things that I didn't say or does things that I didn't say and tells people that I did them, فليتبوأ مقعده من النار, let him guarantee his place in hellfire. And this is a hadith agreed in Bukhari and Muslim and all the books of hadith. As a matter of fact, in the science of hadith, when they want to mention a hadith mutawatir, i.e. a hadith that has been reported by a group number of scholars, sahaba, and that the hadith is truly have come out from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they always mention this hadith, and the other hadith, is about the bid'ah. من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. This hadith was reported through 98 different routes from different sahaba. So this is the highest level of mutawatir. And in all the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we are certain of is about 2 or 3 or 4, maybe 10 hadith that we are sure that they have come out of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with words and meanings. Everything else is a report of whatever happened in meanings. So when they say Qala Rasulullah, they actually not being honest in what they say. They should have said the Prophet ﷺ said in the meaning, as reported in the meaning by people, because they don't report what Rasulullah ﷺ truly said. So this hadith here, at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, people used to make up all these lies like that. They used to lie. Even Muslim alayhi rahmatullah, in his book of Sahih Muslim, in the introduction, he said something extremely, extremely, extremely important and dangerous. He said in a hadith, and he brings his chain of narrator, and then he said that Sa'id al-Qattan, who was born in the year 120, who is also a great man of hadith, he's a great scholar of hadith, and is also the teacher of Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Yahya ibn Ma'in, Ali ibn al-Madini, etc. These people are what they call them the foundation of the science of hadith. I will speak about them when I speak about the science of hadith, because you need to understand these things. When Sa'id al-Qattan was asked, he said, as a Muslim says in his authentic books, لَمْ نَرَى الصَّالِحِينَ فِي شَيْءٍ أَكْذَبَ مِنْهُمْ فِي الْحَدِيثِ. And this is what Muslim says, we did not see the righteous in anything except they are the worst liars when it comes to hadith. What he says is, the righteous people in the time from Muslim to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were the most people who would lie when they transmit the hadith. This is spoken by Muslim himself, subhanallah. Then Muslim alayhi rahmatullah, once he realized what that is, he tried to patch it up, what he said here, that the righteous people were the most liars when it comes to hadith. He said, يجري الكذب على لسانهم, lies flow upon their tongues, ولا يتعمدون الكذب, although they do not intend to lie. Instead, subhanAllah, for him to correct it, he just again made it worse. What Muslim says, that they didn't find, when they were collecting the hadith in Bukhari, Muslim, all this, that the people who would lie a lot about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the righteous people, the scholars and all these kind of people. And then he said, they do not intend deliberately to lie, but lies come out of their tongues. You hang on here, that means they lie without paying attention? And how, if that is the case, how can they be scholars and things like that? The truth of the matter is, people used to lie about the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, unbelievably great. So much so, that Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah, a great scholar that was born in 1116, that is about 900 years between us and them, in a book called Al-Mawdu'at, that is the fabricated hadith, he says, subhanAllah, and he mentioned about 1,847 narrations about people who have fabricated and injected and deeply within people a lot of hadith. And I will cite three examples only, otherwise nobody's got time for 1,847, and you can actually go and read that book. The first one being Abdul Karim, son of Abi Al-Awja. This man said that he had made up 4,000 hadith, and in his final days, he confessed to his deed, saying, Wallahi, by Allah, لقد وضعت فيكم 4,000 حديث. By Allah, I have put within you, I have fabricated and taught and preached 4,000 hadith amongst you. أحرم فيها الحلال, I make the halal haram. وأحل فيها الحرام, and I make the haram halal. ولقد فطرتكم في صومكم, and I have made you break your fast in Ramadan. وَصَوَّمْتُكُمْ فِي فِطْرِكُمْ, and I made you fast instead in the days that you were supposed to be having iftar. So, as you can see, people dedicated 4,000 ahadith. Another scholar who also made up a hadith said, double check who you take your religion from. We used to, when we liked something, we would turn it into a hadith. إِذَا هَوَيْنَا شَيْئًا صَيَّرْنَاهُ حَدِيثًا. This is a scholar that says, and this is a huge problem that took place once between the people of hadith and the people of intellect, the people who would go to Quran. The people of hadith, what they used to do, they used to lie. Whenever, for example, yeah, they would say, for example, don't wear pink. The other one says, why wouldn't I? They say, because Rasulullah. And they would lie there and then, and they will tell him, wearing pink is haram. As you can see about the other one, 4,000, and this one has turned what people like into a hadith. And this was also done by the people of the Hanbali school of thought that is in Saudi Arabia. The third example is of a man that lived in Al-Iraq at the time of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and that is about 1100 years ago. This man was in the masjid, and back then when a scholar would talk or someone would give a talk, before saying Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, they would say the chain of narrator. So this man was in the masjid, there were tons of people sitting there in Iraq, and this man said, Ahmed ibn Hanbal and Ibn Ma'in said to me, And then he went and mentioned a chain of narrators. And then he said, the hadith that Rasulullah ﷺ said, whoever says La ilaha illallah, Allah would create for him, for every word, that means La ilaha illallah, that means four words here, for every word, 70,000 birds. Each bird has got 70,000 beak. Each beak has got 70,000 tongues. Each tongue makes 70,000 astaghfirullah, seeking forgiveness for that person. People were, masha'Allah, beautiful hadith. The man spreads his handkerchief. People started making donations. It just so happened that Allah has decreed that at that time, Ahmed ibn Hanbal and Ibn Ma'in were passing by and they stopped at the masjid to pray. When they heard this hadith, they hastened their salat, and when they finished, Ibn Ma'in calls the man. And the man comes because the man was expecting to receive a donation. So Ibn Ma'in said to him, where did you hear this story? We never heard it before. Oh, and the man went again and told him the narrator. But Ibn Ma'in says to him, well, this is Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and I am Ibn Ma'in, and we've never heard this hadith until this moment. And the man then said to him, I have heard that Ibn Ma'in was an idiot, and now I can see him right in front of me. And then he said, this is the man saying, I have reported a hadith, and I have met 17 Ahmed ibn Hanbal and 17 people who claim to be Ibn Ma'in. And then he rose and left. At that time, my dear sisters and my brothers, people who made up the ahadith were not the normal people. They were scholars, because these people had to know the Arabic language, had to know how to formulate words so that when they say a hadith, it will sound potent. The Arabic will sound strong, and it will sound as it is, as if it were Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam who made it. This is why I personally believe, and I'm not the only one, there are a great number of people, even in Saudi Arabia today, it is starting to move there, that this any hadith that attacks Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly or indirectly are from the Banu Umayyah, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, and his hate for the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is behind this, and rightly so. So to close my talk, my dear sisters and my brothers, are the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in hellfire? Absolutely not. Are they in Jannah? Allah knows. What will happen to them on the day of judgment? None of my business. If Allah wants to put them in Jannah, He is merciful. And if Allah wants to punish them, He is fair and just. But no one has the authority to rule for people's ends in paradise or in hellfire based on a hadith. And since Allah has in Al-Quran explicitly said that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will not hold anyone responsible or punish them if they haven't received a clear messenger that would clearly show them and explain them the signs of Allah, the reality of the matter stays where it is now. I pray to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to enable us to see the truth about our beautiful religion, to prioritize Al-Quran. Believe me, we must return to Al-Quran. And I will say it, we must return to Al-Quran. Enough of Qala Rasulullah, because throughout history, tons of people have lied, and many of the ahadith that seem like it's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam exist today. And as I said in my talk here today, that I will start a series of called contradictions, and you are going to start understanding how the compilations of the hadith started and why we must not be 100% trusting of anything they say, Qala Rasulullah. Always remember that every time somebody says to you, Qala Rasulullah, all they are doing is reporting to you in the meaning. Rasulullah has not said these words. Somebody heard from them, it's the Chinese whisper. And only Allah knows where we are going to end up. And until now, Muslims are not awakening, but inshallah, one day we will awaken. Also, I want to say something before I finish my word here. On the other side, my dear brothers, the Shia, our brothers, the Shia, and I call them brothers because they are Muslims, enough of the Wahhabi Saudi political rubbing that they are kuffar. They are not, my dear brothers and sisters, they are not. And many things that you know about the Shia are nothing else but a propaganda from Saudi Arabian scholars, believe it or not. That falsification of the Quran, and Jibreel made a mistake instead of going to Rasulullah, he went to Rasulullah. All these things are propaganda, and it's a lot of things are lies, really. Wallahi al-Azim, it's sad, Neil, but it's true. But anyway, to say this, that the Shia are on the other side, over exaggerating the status of the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until they made them sinless, ma'soom, i.e. they don't make errors and they are guided by Allah. And this is not true, and many other things. But in any way, my dear sisters and my brothers, the Shia believe that the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are in Jannah and all these things. And I will tell you, my dear sisters and my brothers, we must wake up. Enough time that they have brainwashed us. Enough time that they have propagandized things about. Enough time that they scared us from the Shia, from everyone else, until we became paranoid. We think like everyone else is a kafir, going to hellfire for eternity, except us. It is not true, my brothers. Al-Quran speaks different, and we need to go back to Al-Quran. So one more time, are the parents of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in hellfire? Absolutely not. Are they in Jannah? Allah knows. But all we know that on the Day of Judgment, they have not received the messenger today. Allah Tabarakata will test them. And all the ahadith in al-Bukhari and Muslim and everything else that says Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's parents are in hellfire, just rub them and throw them against the wall. This is the influence of Banu Umayyah. And al-Bukhari is Banu Umayyah. Muslim has got that tendency, and so on and so forth. So I pray to Allah Tabarakata that this talk is clear. Should you have any questions, please do get back to me. My name is Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. To be part of my group on WhatsApp, please do send me a message on WhatsApp, England, that is +44 78 76 40 87 35. The talk will be also on my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk, where you go there and you find, inshallah, around 180 or probably 200 of my Pep Talks. And inshallah, I will hope to see you again in my next talk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.